David Berkowitz pleaded guilty to all six of the so-called Son of Sam murders that terrorized the city for a year. Bill Stewart reports.
Police sirens announced the arrival of Berkowitz at the courthouse amid the tightest security many courthouse observers could remember. Inside, Berkowitz was led handcuffed into the crowded courtroom where sat survivors of the Son of Sam attacks and the relatives of those who were killed. The family of last victim Stacy Moskowitz, seated just in front of the parents of first victim Donna Loria. Beside them, Donna DeMacy, wearing a neck brace from her wounds. Leon Stern, Berkowitz's lawyer, told the court that Berkowitz's insistence on pleading guilty to all charges was contrary to his advice. Stern favored a plea of not guilty by reason of insanity. But Judge Joseph Corso, who had earlier pronounced Berkowitz competent to stand trial, accepted Berkowitz's guilty plea after taking the defendant back through the events of the last Son of Sam shootings. Judge Corso, why did you go out that night, last July 31st? Berkowitz, to kill somebody. Anybody in particular? No. You approached the Moskowitz car? Yes. And I shot them. How many times? Asked the judge. Five, replied Berkowitz. Who did you aim at first? The girl. Who were you trying to shoot? Both of them. Why? So they would die. The dead girl's sister sobbed in the audience. Outside, the father of another victim had this reaction.
Like I said, I don't think, justice was done, but not the way it should have really been done. He still don't deserve to live. I still have to support him for being where he is today and where he'll spend the rest of his life. And never bring my daughter back, and never bring all the other kids back either, but that's all I can say. And I'm sorry, I gotta run. Please, excuse me, huh?
When it was all over and Berkowitz was again led away from the courthouse, he had faced three judges and pleaded guilty to six murders, seven woundings, and lesser crimes. If he receives the maximum punishment at his sentencing 2 weeks from now, Berkowitz faces 25 years to life for each of the six murders alone.
Welcome to True Crime Brewery. I'm Jill.
And I'm Dick.
Now, this is our first commissioned podcast that we're doing today, so I'm really excited about that. And I want to give a big thank you to Todd Feitl for sponsoring this podcast, When Evil Came to Town, The Son of Sam Murders.
Big case.
Yes.
And it continues to be a big case.
Lots going on with it over the years, and I remember it from my childhood.
Yeah, you were just a wee babe.
That's right. So what have you got? You've got beers. I heard you have two beers.
I'm going to do two beers today. I wanted to do a beer that Todd had recommended.
That's good.
And then I wanted to do a beer for the neighborhood where the crimes took place.
Oh, very good.
I've got two today.
Okay. So is Todd's beer from New York?
No, it isn't.
Oh, it's okay. So that's why. Okay. Well, let me just talk a little bit about what we're going to be covering, and then we'll do your beer reviews.
Sounds good.
So in August of 1977... 24-year-old David Berkowitz was taken into custody by the New York City policemen, and he was indicted for eight shooting attacks known as the Son of Sam murders. Now, the killing spree terrorized New Yorkers from July of 1976 to the time of his arrest. As the list of victims grew, the police received letters mocking them and promising more murders. Young female victims were targeted, mostly women with long, dark, wavy hair. But all but one of the crimes involved two victims. Some of the attacks were committed against women who were sitting in cars with their boyfriends. Now, after confessing to the Son of Sam murders, David Berkowitz was given six life sentences. In prison, he began to claim, though, that he joined a satanic cult back in 1975, and that other cult members were actually his accomplices. Now, in these revised confessions, Berkowitz said that he and several other cult members planned the shootings, conducted surveillance of the victims, and acted as lookouts and even as getaway drivers.
Right. We'll talk about that some more.
Absolutely. We'll talk about that a lot.
Yes.
Yeah. So was Berkowitz a disturbed individual who acted alone? Or was he, as he claimed, a member of a satanic cult that planned and carried out ritualistic murders that gripped the city in fear? Now, before we go down to the quiet end for this exploration of the Son of Sam murders, let's see what we have, because we have two beers.
This is a first, isn't it? Two beers.
I believe so, yeah.
I feel like a hog.
No, I think it's great. I think people would probably like 10 beers. I mean, at least the beer people. There are some beer people who like the beer part better than the crime. You've got your you've got your individual lovers there.
I would think probably I'm in the minority from the beer lovers. But anyway, so the beer, we asked Todd if he wanted to recommend a beer or if he wanted to actually even do the beer review. He didn't want to do the review. But we do have a beer he recommended.
That's
And this was a new one to me. I hadn't tried this before. This is called James E. Pepper 1776 American Brown Ale. And it's made by the Georgetown Trading Company in Mount Sterling, Kentucky. So this turns out to be a partnership between a whiskey company, that's the Georgetown Trading Company, and Beltway Brewing Company. So they've aged the Beltway beers in some whiskey barrels.
They're not the first ones to do that, though, right?
No.
But you like the idea.
I like the idea.
Yes.
And I like the way they contracted it out. Anyway, it's an American brown ale, which means that it's a sweet, malty, somewhat fruity, somewhat nutty beer.
So is that citrus fruit or dark fruit?
More darker fruit.
I thought so.
And it has a fairly low hop aroma. So this is one of those more sweet, malty beers, not a lot of hops going on. So this particular one, the James E. Pepper 1776, is a very dark brown beer with a 1 inch or so tan head and good retention. So the head lingers for a long time.
Now, why is that? Is that something desirable to have a lingering head?
In certain beers. I mean, there's others that have virtually no head, but this is pretty cool. So it has an aroma of vanilla, brown sugar, rye whiskey, and toffee. Mm. Sounds pretty good, huh?
It does sound kind of tasty.
And the taste follows the nose. So besides the vanilla, brown sugar, whiskey, and toffee, there's some dark fruit and some smoke, and it's a little bit nutty.
So it sounds like you enjoyed it.
I did.
And Todd must like it because he recommended it.
He recommended it. So okay. I think it's a good beer.
Okay.
Now, do you want to talk about something else or do you want to do the other beer?
Oh, no. Let's kill two beers with one recording.
Okay.
Let's do both beers.
Both beers.
Yeah, let's double beer it. And then people who don't like beer, you can just hit your 15 or 30 second thing a few times.
Fast forward a little bit.
Sure. But if you like beer, you're getting double today.
So the second one I chose, just because these crimes took place in New York City, and this is from Brooklyn Brewery. It's Brooklyn Black Ops beer.
I think I've had that. You've had that at home before, right?
We've had it several times.
Yeah, it's pretty good.
It is, although I think I liked it better than a lot of other people, or at least I rated it more highly than the average.
Okay.
But I thought it was a pretty good beer, and I figured Black Ops sounds like a good name for the Berkowitz Son of Sam murders. So it is a Russian Imperial Stout, which, as we all know, is the king of stouts. Very high alcohol, lots of malt character. It has usually a huge roasted chocolate and burnt malt flavor. Can have some dark fruit and alcohol also. But these tend to be pretty high up on the alcohol by volume.
So a sipping beer maybe more than a refreshing drinking beer.
You're not going to pound a bunch of these back.
No, not a beach party beer.
No, you'll be in a coma. Maybe not in a coma, but
you'd be unconscious.
You'll be sleeping.
Yes.
So this is, as you said, a sipping beer. And it comes in a 25-ounce bottle, so it's meant to be shared with somebody.
Good.
As we've done.
Yes.
So this particular beer we've had is a black color, very black, very dark, hence the Black Ops. And it has a thick, light brown head. Aroma is cocoa, like cocoa powder. You know, you're mixing your chocolate milk drink with cocoa. So it has that, but it also has some chocolate in it, some coffee. And it's fairly boozy.
I would imagine, yeah.
More than fairly boozy.
Yeah.
And the taste was very similar to the aroma. Lots of chocolate, some cocoa, a little bit of coffee, and a lot of booze. The alcohol is a pretty warming effect on the beer.
Well, I think you should drink Todd's beer first because it's less boozy. And then during feedback, you can start drinking the Black Ops.
Okay.
How's that?
That's good.
That's the plan.
That's a great idea.
Yeah, I think about these things.
Although Todd's beer is fairly boozy also.
Oh,
but
okay.
But we'll sip because we've got lots to talk about and we'll probably be ready for the Black Ops by the time we hit the feedback section.
Perfect. All right. Okay. Are we going to open both now? Or do you want to open one at feedback time?
Well,
or do you like to let it breathe for a while or no?
Doesn't have to. But it would be nice. We can let them both sit out so they're more, not quite room temperature, but a little warmer.
Okay.
Because they'll taste better that way.
So you want to open both now?
Sure.
Okay. All right, we're loaded up with stuff. Let's go down to the quiet end.
Yeah, we got two bottles and four glasses. We need to schlep it all down there.
That's right. And it's kind of busy, not terribly busy. A lot of people out on the patio on this nice warm day.
It's a beautiful spring day.
Yeah.
Even though we had snow yesterday, today is a better day.
It's melting away.
It is.
Yeah. All right. So here we are, and let's talk a little bit about David Berkowitz.
All right. This is a fascinating case.
Yes. So David Berkowitz, he was adopted by Pearl and Nathan Berkowitz as an infant. And they were a Jewish-American couple, and they ran a hardware store. And they didn't have any biological children of their own. So he was raised as an only child. Now, the mother that gave birth to him was also Jewish. And it turns out that his biological father was Jewish as well. At first, they thought he might have been Italian because her last name was Falco, but she was actually married to another man, got divorced or was getting divorced, had a daughter, and then she'd gotten pregnant with a married man who was Berkowitz's father. Then when she couldn't marry him because he didn't leave his wife and she was a single woman, she didn't think she could have this boy. So she gave birth to David, and that's why he was adopted at a very young age. By this couple who had no other children.
Yeah, so she did a nice thing.
Yes. Now, although he had an above-average intelligence, he did have a troubled childhood. He seemed to lose interest in school at an early age, and he began stealing and actually setting fires, which is, I know that's a really bad sign.
It is, right?
Right. If a parent comes in and they say, well, here's our six-year-old David, and he's been setting fires, what's your response to that as a pediatrician?
I'm going to send him to a psychiatrist.
And he probably could have used that.
Yeah. I mean, yeah. Arson, same thing with harming pets or animals. And those are big red flags.
Well, that's even worse. Yeah. Yeah. Well, I mean, I think they did take him to a psychiatrist at one point, but let's remember he was born in the 1950s. So a lot less therapy going on, I would think.
Yeah, there was.
Now, neighbors and friends of the family remembered him as being kind of a spoiled bully. His parents did consult a psychotherapist, and he'd had a lot of misconduct at school. He hadn't gotten into any serious legal trouble.
No, but he was already showing a pattern of behavior.
He was.
That definitely raised some flags.
Disruptive, some troubles, yeah.
Yeah.
Now, his adoptive mother, Pearl, died of cancer when he was only 14, so that was tough on him as well. Now, he didn't like the woman his father remarried, and then home life became very difficult in his later teens. So in 1971, he was 18 years old, and he joined the Army. And he ended up serving a little time in South Korea, but never went to Vietnam. And after an honorable discharge in 1974, he decided he was going to search for his birth mother. But he was really disappointed by her and by finding out that he was illegitimate. Although, if you're adopted, I guess you'd think that.
Yeah, I don't know exactly what that reasoning is.
Well, I think he was initially told that she died in childbirth, which is a common thing for people to tell children back then.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The big lie.
Like, anything's better than being illegitimate. Death is better than getting pregnant out of wedlock.
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of the attitude back then. So he was kind of he was really disturbed and troubled that he'd been illegitimate. Probably a little bit angry at her is what I'm getting from what I've read.
I think so.
I think he really...
Because what we were reading initially, when he didn't know that, he had a fairly good relationship with his birth mother.
Yes, yeah. I think he liked her a lot.
It started out that way. And then he found out that she had an affair with a married guy, and that soured things for him.
Well, another point of contention was the older sister that didn't get put out for adoption and was kept. I think he resented her.
Oh, definitely.
Yes. Now, his first violent crime was committed on Christmas Eve, 1975. He stabbed two women with a hunting knife. Now, teenager Michelle Foreman was hospitalized for her injuries. The other woman was okay, and she wasn't identified by police. So, he wasn't a suspect, though. They didn't know he had anything to do with it. He got away with it, in other words.
He did. I mean, the only reason we found out about it was because he confessed to that.
True. Very true. So, shortly after the attack, he moved to Yonkers, and that's just north of the city. And Donna Loria, this was an 18-year-old girl, and that's his first victim. So it was on July 29th, 1976, and she worked for the Empire State Ambulance Service. Her friend Jody Valentini was 19, and she worked as a nurse at the New York Hospital. So these two young women, they were discussing their summer vacation plans when their killer approached their car, pulled out a long-barreled pistol, and opened fire on them. So he didn't say a word, and Jody was wounded in the left thigh. She actually didn't die. Donna was killed instantly, though.
Yeah, she got shot in the head.
Yes. A third bullet was also fired, but it missed both of them. Now, Jody would tell police that she didn't recognize the shooter, and she described him as a white male in his 30s with a fair complexion, about 5 feet 9 inches tall, and about 160 pounds, with short, dark, curly hair. So other than saying he's about 10 years older than he really was, that description pretty much matches David Berkowitz, wouldn't you think?
It absolutely does.
Now, this description was also supported by Donna's father, who said that he saw a similar man parked in their neighborhood, and he'd been driving around in a yellow car around the neighborhood for a while. So probably stalking, waiting for these particular girls, or just looking for people? Not sure. But the father had seen the car around a couple hours before the girls even got home.
Right. And I think the view is that the killer was targeting the girl that got killed.
Yes.
And was reconnoitering the neighborhood.
Mm-hmm. Yep. So on October 23rd of 1976, so what's that, like 3 months later, there was a similar attack, and it occurred in a secluded area of Flushing, Queens, near Bone Park? Or is it Bourne? Oh, I can't read for sure what the name of the park was. But anyway, it was in Flushing, Queens.
I'll bet it's Bourne Park.
I bet you're right. But Carl De Niro, 20 years old, and Rosemary Keenan, 18 years old. So they're sitting in Rosemary's parked car, and suddenly the window's shattered. Rosemary started the car and sped away to get help for Carl, who'd been shot in the head. Now, Rosemary only had superficial injuries from the glass, but Carl needed a metal plate to replace the damaged part of his skull. And neither of these people had witnessed who shot them. They're just sitting there. Next thing they know, the glass shatters.
Right.
So there was no eyewitness testimony with this crime.
None.
So Carl, he'd been planning to join the Air Force, and his injury ended his military career before it even really got started. He had shoulder-length hair, so the shooter may have mistaken him for a girl. Now, Rosemary's father was a New York Police Department detective with over 20 years of service. So he really helped to push for an intense investigation with this shooting.
Sure, but they weren't connecting the two shootings yet.
No, they're not connected.
These are two
separate places.
Separate occasions.
Yeah. And there was really no known motive. The shooting had similarities to the shootings of Donna Loria and Jody Valentis.
But they occurred in different locations, and they didn't connect the two.
Right. They're different boroughs. They're different police precincts.
Right. Yep.
So it's not connected.
Not yet, anyway.
Right. Now, Donna DeMasi, 16 years old, and Joanne Lamino, 18 years old. These two girls walked home from a movie on the night of November 27th, 1976, so a little over a month later. And they were sitting on Joanne's porch when a man dressed in military fatigues came up to them. And he was pretending to ask for directions. He drew a gun from his coat, and he shot each of the young women twice. After they fell to the ground, he fired several other shots. So a neighbor heard the gunshots, rushed out of the apartment building, and this witness saw a blonde man run by holding a pistol. So Donna DeMasi was shot twice in the neck, and she would describe the shooter as a white man between 25 and 30 years old. Joanne Lamino had one bullet lodged in her spine, and she was actually paralyzed from the waist down from this shooting.
Right, and she's remained a paraplegic.
Yes.
From the shooting.
It was permanent, yeah. So What about this description, though, of a blonde man? So this is different.
This is a different description.
It is, right. But they still haven't connected these crimes.
No.
So Christine Freund, 26 years old, was a secretary who was shot to death on January 30th, 1977. So that's like 2 months after the last one. And it was 12:30 a.m. when she sat in a parked car with her boyfriend, John Deal, in Queens. Now, the couple had seen the movie Rocky, the original Rocky, and they'd gone out to dinner before they walked out to John's car. So they sat in the car for 2 minutes while the engine warmed up, and the killer approached the car from behind and fired 3 shots through the car window. Now, Christine was struck in the head and right shoulder, and she died hours later at the hospital. John did survive, but he had some injuries, and neither of them had seen the attacker either.
Right. These are just kind of sneak attacks.
Absolutely. And yeah. They seem to come out of nowhere.
People are sitting in their cars, talking, doing whatever, and the gunman appears. Boom.
Yeah. So, as you can imagine, this is going to be scary for people in the community.
It is.
Because you don't know.
You don't. But it's going to get scarier because they're going to eventually put the attacks together or link them and say that there's some serial shooter out there.
Right. So police did acknowledge publicly that this shooting was similar to the other shootings. All of the victims also had been shot with a .44 caliber bullet, and the shooting seemed to target young women with long dark hair. So New York Police Department Sergeant Richard Conlin said that police were leaning towards a connection in all the cases. Sketches were released of the dark-haired shooter of Donna Loria and Jody Valenti, and the blonde shooter of Joanne Lamino and Donna DeMasi. Now, police noted that they were looking for more than one suspect, though, because of these descriptions.
Right. They have two different eyewitness descriptions.
So at this point, they're thinking, yes, it was done by the same people, but not one person.
Right. Not one person, but at least two.
Right. Yeah. So the next shooting happened on March 8th, 1977, when a 19-year-old girl, Virginia, and my pronunciation of easy words is bad, so this is going to be...
Voskarichian.
Thank you. A Columbia University student was walking home from school and was approached by an armed man. Now, Virginia was a Russian language student. She was slender, 5 feet 6 inches tall, with dark eyes and dark hair. She was described by her teachers and classmates as an excellent student with a gift for languages and a love of Russian literature. Her family had immigrated from Bulgaria, and she lived only one block from where Christine Freund was shot. So in a move to defend herself, Virginia had moved her textbooks between herself and the killer. But she was shot in her mouth, right in her face, from close range. And then she was found lying face down in the bushes near the sidewalk. So moments after Virginia was shot, a resident who heard the gunshot nearly ran into a person that he would describe as short, husky, and only 16 to 18 years old. Now, this teenager was clean-shaven, she said, and he was wearing a sweater and a hat, and he was running away from the crime scene.
Yeah, well, short and stocky would describe Berkowitz.
Yeah, but 16 to 18 years old? Well, I don't know.
He's early 20s.
Yeah.
So...
I guess it could.
And the same thing as the first witness, the father of the lady that got shot, said he was, or the girlfriend.
They thought he was 35.
Thought he was in his 30s. But, I mean, I think it's difficult at night judging age, and I'd be looking more at size and body habitus. But anyway.
Okay. And then the hair, some people have said he could have been wearing a wig when he had the blonde hair in that one crime.
Right.
Okay.
Or it could have been someone else.
Right. Absolutely.
So the resident who was the eyewitness said that the teen pulled his cap down over his face and said, "Oh, Jesus," as he ran by. Other neighbors also saw the teenager, as well as a man matching Berkowitz's description, loitering separately in the area for about an hour before the killing. So again, maybe there's more than one person involved.
So did that witness see both of them together?
No.
Oh, okay. So he saw them separately. So it could have been the same guy.
Could have been.
Okay.
The New York Police Department and the New York City Mayor Abraham Beame held a press conference on March 10th, 1977. In this conference, they declared that the same .44 caliber bulldog revolver had fired the shots that killed Donna Loria and Virginia Voskarichian. So big time stuff is happening now.
So that's a big connection.
Right.
Right. So now they're going to put it together quite a bit.
So the crimes became daily stories on the news and in newspapers.
Sure. And this is a big deal.
Absolutely. Because we've got kind of a serial killer now.
Yes. Unpredictable as well. Very unpredictable.
Very. Now, about a little over a month later, Victoria Suriani, who was 18, was sitting in her car with her 20-year-old friend Alexander Esau near her home in the Bronx when each of them was shot twice. Both these people died. Valentina died at the scene and Alexander died in the hospital a few hours later.
Right. So her name was Valentina, not Victoria.
Did I say Victoria?
You did the first time. It's okay. I mean, I do it all the time, so you can do it once in a while.
Valentina.
Yes. So Valentina, she'd been a quiet, smart girl, and she lived with her parents. She was a graduate of St. Catherine's Roman Catholic High School in the Bronx. She had plans to study at the Fashion Institute of Technology in Manhattan. Valentina and Alexander were approached on the driver's side of the car, and their killer shot through a closed window. Now, after this shooting, police found a handwritten note near their bodies. It was written in mostly block capital letters, and it addressed the NYPD captain, Joseph Borelli. Now, in this note, the name Son of Sam made its preview. Now, previously, the press had called the killer the .44 caliber killer. Now, some of the contents of the note were revealed to the press, and the name Son of Sam became known to the public. You want to talk a little bit about the note, or?
Well, I'll read the letter.
Yeah, why don't you just read it? Is this the note that was left by the shooting?
Right.
Not the Breslin letter.
No.
Okay.
You're going to talk the Breslin letter. This is the letter that was sent to the attorney, or district attorney Borelli.
This one was left with the crime that I'm talking about.
Right.
Okay.
But it's addressed to him.
I see. Okay. I get it.
So it reads, I am deeply hurt by your calling me a woman hater. I am not, but I am a monster. I am the son of Sam. There's the name.
Okay.
I am a little brat. When Father Sam gets drunk, he gets mean. He beats our family. Sometimes he ties me up to the back of the house. Other times he locks me in the garage. Sam loves to drink blood. Get out and kill, commands Father Sam. Behind our house, some rest. Mostly the attic, too. I am on a different wavelength than everyone else, programmed to kill. However, to stop me, you must kill me. Tension all police, shoot me first. Shoot to kill, or else keep out of my way, or you will die.
That's weird.
Isn't it?
Yeah.
Papa Sam is old now. He needs some blood to preserve his youth. He has too many heart attacks. Ugh, me heart, it hurts, sonny boy. I miss my pretty princess most of all. She's resting in Our Lady's house, but I'll see her soon. I am the monster, Beelzebub, the chubby behemoth. I love to hunt, prowling the street looking for fair game. Tasty meat. The women of Queens are prettiest of all. I must be the water they drink. I live for the hunt. My life, blood for Papa, Mr. Borelli, sir. I don't want to kill any more. No, sir. No more than, but I must. Honor thy father. I want to make love to the world. I love people. I don't believe I belong on earth. Return me to the father. Return me to Yahoo's. To the people of Queens, I love you, and I want to wish you all a happy Easter day. God bless you in this life and in the rest. And for now, I say goodbye and good night. Police, let me haunt you with these words. I'll be back. I'll be back. To be interpreted as hang, hang, bang, bang, ugh. Yours in murder, Mr. Monster. So psychiatrists analyzed this letter, and they thought that the shooter might have paranoid schizophrenia.
Sounds like a possibility.
I mean, this is a really disjointed
letter. And what about the Easter comment, though? He was Jewish.
Yeah.
So that's weird.
It is.
Unless he was getting involved in other religious things, which is part of the conspiracy theory, right?
Right.
Okay. And there were lots of things over the years that it would have been kind of decoded and interpreted from that letter.
Yeah, I think you can parse this letter ad infinitum and find new ways to interpret it.
Right, right.
But it's certainly a strange letter, isn't it?
Yes. And it did make its way to the public, right? And how did that happen?
Yeah. Well, I think the police released parts of it. They didn't drop the whole letter all at once.
Well, you don't want to do that because if someone confesses, you want them to have information that everybody wouldn't have.
Absolutely.
Right. And how did he know who this detective was? It was a detective?
No, it was a district attorney, wasn't it?
Oh, is that what you said? Okay. How did he know who the district attorney was? I guess you could just find that out.
Yeah, I think you can read in the papers that so-and-so is investigating
the
murders
question.
Or the shootings.
Okay.
So he knows.
Yeah. Okay.
But it really is a rambling, disjointed letter.
That makes you think the person who wrote it is quite mentally ill.
It does, doesn't it?
Yeah. What about all the references to Son of Sam and that will turn out? Did you want to talk about it all, who Sam was? I have that later on we could talk about.
Yeah.
Let's go through all the shootings first.
That's fine. We can discuss Son of Sam down the road.
Okay. Because there was another shooting just in June, and it was Judy Placido, a 17-year-old, was shot in the right temple, right shoulder, and the back of her neck as she sat parked in her friend Salvador Lupo's car in Bayside, Queens. Now, this couple had walked to his car from the Elefa's discotheque half a block away. Now, they'd been sitting in the car for about 10 minutes when the shooter approached from behind and fired 4 shots and wounded both of them. Now, Judy Placido had just graduated from St. Catherine's Roman Catholic Church as well in the Bronx. That's where Valentino Suriani had graduated a year earlier before her. Now, she planned to attend Pace University's College of White Plains and study law. Judy had gone to the discotheque with 2 girlfriends, and she decided to stay behind with Salvador, who she'd been dating, when her friends went home a little earlier. Now, Salvador and Judy, they both survived the shooting. Salvador was only wounded in his right forearm. Neither of them had seen their attacker, though. But now there were 2 witnesses that reported seeing a tall, dark-haired man in a leisure suit fleeing the scene. Now, one witness claimed to see him leave in a car and supplied a partial license plate number. Another described a blonde man with a mustache who drove from the scene in a Chevy Nova without turning on its headlights.
Doesn't sound like Berkowitz, does it?
No. Now, police speculated that the dark-haired man may have been the shooter, and the blonde man may have observed the shooting. So they think it was 2 guys here.
Right. No. As in a previous shooting.
Right.
That there might have been more than one person involved.
Yes. But the 8th and final attack occurred just over a year after the first attack. So it was early July. It was early in the day on July 31st, 1977. And Stacy Motzkowitz and Robert Violante, both 20 years old, were in Robert's car parked under a streetlight near a city park in Bath Beach, Brooklyn. So they were kissing when a man approached the passenger side and fired 4 shots into their car. Stacy and Robert were both shot in the head. Stacy died hours later in the hospital. Robert survived, but Robert lost all the vision in one of his eyes, and then he only retained about 20% of the vision in his other eye. So I imagine he's legally blind. And
absolutely.
It's a significant handicap.
Yeah.
Yeah. So this crime had more witnesses than any of the other Son of Sam murders, though. Now, during the shooting, 19-year-old Tommy Zeno caught a glimpse of the shooting as he approached. So he was parked with his date and 3 cars in front of Robert and Stacy. Now, Zeno glanced at his rearview mirror and he saw the perpetrator for several seconds due to the bright streetlight and the full moon. He would later describe the shooter as a man between 25 and 30 years old, 5'7" to 5'9", with dark blonde or light brown shaggy hair. So Zeno also said that the hair looked like a wig, though. So other than the hair, that could be describing David Berkowitz.
Could be.
Then 1 minute after the shooting, a woman seated next to her boyfriend in his car saw a white male wearing a light-colored, cheap nylon wig run from the park and get into a small, light-colored car and drive away quickly. Now, she was able to recall the first 2 letters on the license plate, but the others were either 4GUR or 4GVR. Now, other witnesses included a woman who saw a light-colored car speed away from the park about 20 minutes after hearing the gunshots. Also, there were three witnesses who described a yellow Volkswagen driving quickly from the neighborhood with its headlights off. Another witness, given the pseudonym Mary Lyons, heard gunshots and Violenti's calls for help and looked out of her apartment window to see a man whom she later positively identified as David Berkowitz at the police station. So she said that this guy who looked like David Berkowitz was walking casually away from the crime scene as other people were rushing toward the crime scene to help out. So that's suspicious.
It certainly is.
And then after 2:35 a.m., a man who was given the pseudonym Alan Masters was driving through an intersection a few blocks from the park, and he was nearly hit by what he described as a yellow Volkswagen Beetle that sped through the intersection without its headlights on, and the driver ran a red light. Now, Berkowitz did have a small yellow car, but it wasn't a Beetle.
No, it wasn't. It was a Ford something or other.
I think it was a Galaxy.
Okay.
Which I don't know what those looked like, but this witness was really angry and upset that the car was speeding and almost hit him. So he followed the car for several blocks, actually. And he described the driver as a white man in his late 20s to early 30s with a narrow face, dark hair, dark facial hair, but he didn't get the license plate number at all.
Okay.
So that doesn't give us a whole lot of information.
No, it doesn't.
There was another witness, though, Thomas Scally, and he was sitting in Alley Pond Park on Winchester Boulevard at dusk with a female friend when a yellow Volkswagen Beetle approached his car and stopped door to door, just inches away from his car. But Scally kept an air gun under his seat, and as the VW came up alongside his car, the VW driver was met with an air gun pointed straight at his face. So this guy was on top of things.
He doesn't mess around, does he?
No. He didn't even know that, you know, who it was or anything.
No. He's got his gun drawn and ready.
Yeah. Now, the VW driver, who Scally described as a light-skinned black male, quickly put his car in reverse and drove out of the parking lot. So Scally chased the car to a point in Glen Oaks when the driver jumped out and ran. Scally didn't want to leave his girlfriend in the car, he said, so he didn't chase the man on foot.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So, we've got these different witnesses, and they're kind of giving similar descriptions, although there are some differences.
Yeah, there are. I mean, there's enough discrepancy there, and we'll talk about that.
It's enough to make you wonder, at least.
Right. It does. So, police didn't know about the Moskowitz-Violanti shooting until about 2:50 a.m. They set up roadblocks about an hour after the shooting, stopping hundreds of cars to question drivers. Police now believe that the shooter owned or drove a Volkswagen. And over the next couple of days, they learned that there were about 900 Volkswagens in New York or New Jersey. They plan to trace each of these Volkswagens and do background checks on the owners.
That's a lot to deal with.
It sure is. It's heavy manpower, isn't it?
But it seems like Volkswagens were popular back then. I know I had an uncle who worked at a Volkswagen dealer, so we had Volkswagens for that reason. But it seemed like they were everywhere, especially the Beetle.
Oh, everybody had
very
a bug.
Very popular.
Right.
Didn't you have a bug at one point?
I did.
Yeah.
I had a 68 bug.
Oh, an older one.
When they remodeled it, kind of. So I had the big tail lights and everything. It was pretty cool.
I bet you were really something.
I was. But anyway, yeah, I had a powder blue 68 bug.
Nice.
So we talked a little about the letter left at the crime scene in April of 1977, and this was directed to Borelli, who, I misspoke, is actually a police detective.
Oh, okay.
Not a prosecutor.
Not the DA.
Well,
that makes me feel less stupid.
So anyway, I think either way you can find out the guy's name just from what's in the newspapers.
Sure you can, yeah. That kind of stuff is out there.
It was. So, but on May 30th, 1977, there was another handwritten letter sent to the Daily News' columnist, Jimmy Breslin, famous guy who just died a week or two ago.
A little longer than that, I think, but recently, yeah.
Recently.
Yeah.
Someone sent the letter, and he claimed to be the .44 caliber shooter.
Right.
The letter was postmarked from Englewood, New Jersey, and on the back of the envelope, neat print read, "Blood and Family, Darkness and Death, Absolute Depravity, 44.
Yeah. So the letter inside, it said, Hello from the gutters of NYC, which are filled with dog manure, vomit, stale wine, urine, and blood. So that's quite an opening.
Isn't it?
Hello from the sewers of NYC, which swallow up these delicacies when they are washed away by the sweeper trucks. Hello from the cracks in the sidewalks of NYC, and from the ants that dwell in these cracks and feed in the dried blood of the dead that settled into the cracks. JB, which is Jimmy Breslin, I'm just dropping you a line to let you know that I appreciate your interest in those recent and horrendous 44 killings. I also want to tell you that I read your column daily, and I find it quite informative. Tell me, Jim, what will you have for July 29th? So July 29th would have been the one-year anniversary of the first shooting.
Right.
Which is something they were focused on, thinking he was going to do something. The police were worried about that. Well, everybody was, right?
Well, yeah. I mean, the city's in a panic.
Yeah. So he's also, then it went on to say, you can forget about me if you like, because I don't care for publicity. However, you must not forget Donna Loria, and you cannot let the people forget her either. She was a very, very sweet girl, but Sam's a thirsty lad, and he won't let me stop killing until he gets his fill of blood. Mr. Breslin, sir, don't think that because you haven't heard from me for a while that I went to sleep. No, rather, I am still here, like a spirit roaming the night, thirsty, hungry, seldom stopping to rest. Anxious to please Sam. I love my work. Now the void has been filled. Perhaps we shall meet face to face some day, or perhaps I will be blown away by cops with smoking 38s. Whatever, if I shall be fortunate enough to meet you, I will tell you all about Sam if you like, and I will introduce you to him. His name is Sam the Terrible. Not knowing what the future holds, I shall say farewell, and I will see you at the next job, or should I say, you will see my handiwork at the next job. Remember Ms. Loria, thank you. In their blood and from the gutter, Sam's creation, 44. Here are some names to help you along. Forward them to the inspector for use. So then he gives these strange names or titles. The Duke of Death, the Wicked King Wicker, the 22 Disciples of Hell, John Wheaties Rapist and Suffocator of Young Girls. Then there's a P.S. Please inform all the detectives working the slaying to remain that I wish them the best of luck. Keep 'em digging, drive on, think positive, get off your butts, knock on coffins, etc. Upon my capture, I promise to buy you guys working the case a new pair of shoes if I can get up the money. Son of Sam. So a lot of these things were in the book you read. We're trying to decipher them, so I'll leave that for you. Underneath the Son of Sam was a logo or a sketch that combined several symbols, and the question, what will you have for July 29th, was considered a really ominous threat because it would have been the one-year anniversary of the first 44 caliber shooting. So Breslin, he notified police, who thought the letter was probably from someone with real knowledge of the shootings. The Breslin letter was sophisticated, though, in comparison to that first letter. It seemed to have been created in an art studio or similar professional location by someone with talent in printing and calligraphy. It was kind of fancy.
Right.
And the other one was primitive.
It was. The first one was very primitive. This one was more sophisticated, I guess.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, sophisticated. Word. Seems like someone with a little more, I don't know, knowledge of grammar.
Yeah.
Someone well-read. Strange. Right. But they did say that David Berkowitz was intelligent, So I don't know what to make of that.
No. And not to overemphasize things, this was a time of panic in New York City.
Yeah, people are afraid.
Women were cutting their hair short, dyeing their hair, so that they didn't look like a long-haired brunette.
I know, right?
This is horrible.
It is. And not going out as much at all.
Oh.
Usual places were really dead.
A lot of the clubs and stuff, which expected full houses, were virtually empty.
That's right, which I could see. I wouldn't want my daughter going out at night, and I wouldn't want to do it myself, knowing someone's loose that you don't know where they're going to hit and what they're going to do to you. It's frightening.
Very. I mean, if I had a teenage or early 20-year-old daughter, I wouldn't want them going out.
No.
Say, you stay home tonight.
or even a son. I wouldn't want him going on dates with girls or parking.
Don't go out with those long-haired girls.
Yeah, right. Although a lot of the boys had long hair then, too. It's the 70s.
Right.
Pretty common for boys to have long hair.
Speculation of one of the shootings was that Berkowitz, whoever did the shooting, mistook the guy for a girl.
Possibly, yeah.
So the unusual writing in the Breslin letter also caused the police to speculate if the writer could be a letterer for comic books. They questioned staff members of DC Comics to see if they recognized the lettering. Wicked King Wicker line led to a private screening for detectives of a 1973 horror movie, The Wicker Man.
Yeah, I mean, they have a lot of people working on this, picking this letter apart for any clue they can find.
A week later, the New York Daily News published the letter, and Breslin encouraged the killer to surrender to police. The article made the paper the highest-selling edition to date. More than 1 million copies were sold. These days, you wouldn't get that many. They'd be online looking at it.
Oh, yeah, hardly anyone. I don't know if it's hardly anyone, but a lot of people don't get the paper.
So police got thousands of tips based on references in the publicized portions of the letter, all which led nowhere. Since the shooting victims had long dark hair, thousands of women in New York got short haircuts and red or blonde hair color.
Right.
Right.
Yeah. And wigs, too. Wigs were selling out.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So getting back to the final shooting, Cecilia Davis, who was a local resident in the area where Moskowitz and Violante had been shot, she'd been walking her dog at the scene of the murder or shooting, and she saw patrol officer Michael Cataneo ticketing a car that was parked near a fire hydrant. After the police left, a young man walked past her who seemed to be holding some kind of dark object. She was a little worried, so she ran to her home. Later heard shots fired behind her in the street. Now, she waited a few days before she contacted police, but then she called them and gave the information about what she saw.
Well, yeah, she didn't know they were shots.
No.
No, she thought maybe it was firecrackers or something.
Yep.
And you're not going to go right to thinking it's shots unless you're familiar with that sound. So after they heard from her, the police checked every car that had been ticketed in the area that night. Now, David Berkowitz's 1970 four-door yellow Ford Galaxy was one of those cars. Police then considered Berkowitz a witness, not a suspect.
Right.
Now,
we're going to talk to everybody that got tickets and see if they know anything.
Sure, which makes sense. And it was August 9th, 1977, when the NYPD detective James Justice called the Yonkers police to ask them to schedule an interview with Berkowitz. So according to Mike Novotny, a Yonkers police sergeant, the Yonkers police had suspicions about Berkowitz in connection with other strange crimes in Yonkers. They thought that these crimes were referred to in the Son of Sam letters as well. So it was the Yonkers police who told the NYPD detectives that Berkowitz might actually be the Son of Sam, not just a witness.
Right.
Now, some of that's denied by some of the police in New York City. But this,
well, sure, you're going to
cover
yourself.
Because they don't
want
to admit that, right?
Yeah.
But the next day, on August 10th, police investigated Berkowitz's car. Now, it was parked in the street outside of his apartment building, and they saw a rifle in the back seat. So they searched the car. They found a duffel bag filled with ammunition. They found maps of the crime scenes. And they found a threatening letter that was addressed to Inspector Dowd of the Omega Task Force. Now, we haven't really talked about that, but they actually put together a task force for these Son of Sam shootings.
Well, sure.
That's what they called it.
I mean, you have to have kind of a central command post.
Right, exactly.
Who's running the investigation, so.
Exactly. So they decided to wait for Berkowitz to leave his apartment instead of risking a violent confrontation in the building with him.
Probably a good idea, because they don't know what they're going to be dealing with.
Right, exactly. Well, if he's shot people already,
yeah,
I'm sure they're on high alert. Now, their first search of his car, though, it was based on this visible rifle in the back seat, even though it's not illegal necessarily to have a rifle in your back seat. So they waited for a search warrant before they searched the apartment. They didn't want anything to legally block them from using whatever evidence they did find.
Probably a good idea.
Now, Berkowitz reached his car around 10 p.m. that night, and Detective John Volatico went to the driver's side, and he pointed his gun inches from Berkowitz's temple. Another detective, William Gardella, pointed his gun at Berkowitz from the passenger side of the car. So they've got him trapped there. Got him from both sides.
Right. They're not taking any chances.
Absolutely not. Now, next to Berkowitz in his car, police found a paper bag with a .44 caliber Bulldog revolver. So that kind of ties things together for them right there.
The gun that was, or the bullets from the gun that were found at the scenes.
Right.
So people knew that it was a .44 gun. Absolutely. .44 caliber gun.
Yes. And I guess this Bulldog, which I know nothing about guns, but is kind of rare from what I could.
Right. Not terribly common.
No. Detective Filatico would later recall that Berkowitz had a smile on his face when they approached him at the car, which was strange. But he was weird, right? Any kind of footage you see, he was behaving oddly.
Yeah. I mean, you get the impression, or maybe more than the impression, that Berkowitz didn't have many social graces.
No, he was definitely odd. So what he had said to Berkowitz is, he said, "Now that I've got you, who have I got?" And Berkowitz answered, "You know, I'm Sam, David Berkowitz." So he did say that he was Sam right then.
Right.
He didn't try and deny it.
But there's also some other witnesses that say his first words were, "You got me, what took you so long?"
Yeah, and I don't know. They think that might have just been lore or an urban legend. I don't know if he said that.
Yeah, we don't know if he said either of those statements.
No, only those two guys would know.
Yeah.
So when police searched the apartment, it was a mess with satanic graffiti on the walls. And they found his diaries, too. These diaries dated back to when he was 21, so about 3 years. It was 3 notebooks, and they were full of notes recounting hundreds of arsons that he'd set in New York. Some sources have claimed that he set over 1,000 fires.
Right.
And I don't know, he may have killed people in those fires as well. I'm not sure.
Well, I would think if you set that many fires, you might have caused bodily harm to some people.
Yes.
Unless he already was picking abandoned buildings or something, but geez.
Well, I mean, even if you don't mean to kill anyone, you're always taking that risk if you set a fire that you're going to hurt somebody.
Absolutely.
I know that there have been fires of abandoned buildings where there were homeless people killed, or there was one noteworthy one, I believe it was in Boston, where there were homeless people and the firemen saved them, but a fireman or two was killed.
Right. Yeah, I think that was Worcester, Lawrence, somewhere.
Somewhere in Massachusetts.
Somewhere in Massachusetts.
Yep. So Berkowitz was held at the Yonkers Police Station and then transferred to the 60th Precinct in Coney Island. That's where the Son of Sam Task Force had set up its headquarters. So the mayor, Abraham Beam, went to the station and he saw Berkowitz, but he didn't speak to him at all. Now, Berkowitz was interrogated without an attorney, and that lasted, from different accounts, 30 to 40 minutes.
Not long.
I've heard different numbers from different things I've read.
Yeah, but he was...
But a very short time.
He was confessing.
Yes. So this was the morning of August 11th, and he confessed to the shootings. During the interrogation, he claimed that his neighbor's dog demanded the blood of pretty young girls, and that was one reason for the killings. He also said that the Sam he had mentioned in the first letter was a former neighbor of his by the name of Sam Carr. And he becomes a big part of this whole conspiracy theory that you read about.
Oh, he does. Sam Carr had 2 sons that were apparently involved in the same satanic cult as David Berkowitz.
Right.
And both these sons died under kind of mysterious circumstances. So Berkowitz said that Sam Carr's black Labrador retriever, Harvey, was possessed by an ancient demon. Now, this doesn't sound like too much of a sane person, right?
No, it doesn't.
Demon was sending directions to Berkowitz on killing people. So here's my excuse. I've been listening to a dog possessed by a demon who's telling me to kill people.
Well, if you're a paranoid schizophrenic, you do hear voices.
You do.
So that's
where... I don't know how you interpret dog voices, though.
I don't know. You just think that's where it's coming from?
Yeah.
He didn't like dogs, I think.
He didn't.
No.
I mean, he tried to harm a dog or kill a dog.
Well, Harvey was shot, but they never had proof that it was David right. that did it. Yeah. And he did survive the shooting.
So, but, I mean, they evaluated him from a mental health aspect, obviously.
Several times, yes.
So, three independent health examinations. Berkowitz was found competent to stand trial.
Now, does that mean that he didn't have schizophrenia? Can you have schizophrenia and still be competent?
Sure.
Okay.
And you can be crazier than a bedbug and still be found competent.
As long as you can tell right from wrong and you know what happened.
Yes.
Yeah.
Right?
I think so. I think you're right. Yeah.
So Berkowitz's defense advised him to enter a plea of not guilty by reason of insanity. But Berkowitz insisted that he pled guilty, that he plead guilty. He had his court date on May 8, 1978, and at this date he appeared very calm and collected. However, on his sentencing, 2 weeks later, Berkowitz tried to jump from the window of the seventh-floor courtroom. He got restrained by bailiffs. Then he began to shout over and over again, "Stacy was a whore. I'd kill her again. I'd kill them all again." Stacy was Stacy Moskowitz, the last victim.
Yes, right.
So another psych evaluation was ordered before sentencing could continue. With this evaluation, Berkowitz drew a sketch of a jailed man and wrote, "I am not well, not well at all." But he was again found competent.
Right, right.
So we can sentence him.
Yeah, so it was...
So they never did a trial.
No.
To speak of.
No.
And he...
He pled guilty, yep.
And got a bunch of life sentences.
Yeah, it was in June of 1978. He got 25 years to life for each murder. Now, the guilty plea terms made him eligible for parole in 25 years, though. Now, that's much to the chagrin of the prosecutors.
I'll bet.
That's what the terms were. He was sent to Attica, an upstate New York maximum security prison. And in a February 1979 interview, Berkowitz said that his stories of demonic possession were just a hoax. In his sessions with a court-appointed psychiatrist, he stated that he had planned murders to get revenge because he felt rejected and hurt by the world at large. He admitted to extreme anger and resentment related to his failures with women, and this led him to target pretty young women. So when Berkowitz was arrested, he was held in a psychiatric ward at Kings County Hospital, and then he was taken to Sing Sing Prison. Then he went to Clinton Correctional Facility for his psychiatric and physical examinations. He spent an additional 2 months at the Central New York Psychiatric Center, and then he was sent to Attica. Now, Berkowitz had an attempt on his life in Attica in 1979. The left side of his neck was slashed, and he had over 50 stitches to repair this wound. Now, he wouldn't tell authorities who attacked him. So, after 10 years in Attica, he was moved to Sullivan Correctional Facility, and several years later, to Shawangunk Correctional Institution. Now, it was in 1987 that Berkowitz became an evangelical Christian. He claimed that he was no longer Son of Sam. He said he was the Son of Hope.
That's quite a switch from Judaism to an evangelical Christian, isn't it?
Yeah, but a lot of people seem to do that in prison.
Yeah, fine religion.
Yeah. Now, his first parole hearing was in 2002. Berkowitz wrote to the governor of New York, though, and asked that it be canceled. In this letter, he wrote that he deserved to be in prison for life. He's been allowed parole hearings every 2 years, but he's not asked to be released in any of these parole hearings.
No, he says he still might kill again.
Yeah. Now, in his latest parole hearing in 2016, Berkowitz said that he'd improved himself in prison, and at that point he didn't feel that he was a risk to anyone. His lawyer also noted that he'd been a model prisoner, but parole was denied. Now, with the assistance of evangelical Christian groups, Berkowitz wrote his memoirs. So the book form of his memoirs was titled Hope, The Prison Journals of David Berkowitz, and that was published in 2006. Now, when Berkowitz was admitted to Sullivan Correctional after leaving Attica, he started to claim that he had joined a satanic cult in 1975. And this is what will relate to a lot of these satanic cult theories.
Right.
Now, he said he met some members at a party initially, and he thought their activities were seances, fortune-telling, that kind of thing. but he later was taught by them about sadism, how to commit murder, and also was introduced to drug use. There were 22 core New York cult members he referred to as the 22 Disciples of Hell, and I believe those were in the Breslin letter. The 22 Disciples of Hell was one of his phrases.
I mean, there is a lot of interpretation of the Breslin letter that he was writing in codes and giving them directions to places and stuff.
Right, yeah. Now, according to Berkowitz, there were cult members throughout the United States in this group. Big group of people going around the country killing people. Now, this was near the Satanic Panic era, so people are pretty freaked out about all that stuff.
Right.
And he's claiming to be part of that.
Now, just backtracking a little bit, almost immediately after his arrest, after the final shootings, questions were raised about Berkowitz's involvement in the Moskowitz Violante shooting. So there are eyewitnesses, as you've mentioned, that seem to indicate a different perpetrator.
Yes, or more than one, right?
More than one.
Yeah.
So, and actually, maybe this final one was filmed.
What do you mean?
That the cult members...
Oh, I don't remember reading that.
Yeah.
Oh, that's fascinating.
But we'll get around to that.
The crime itself was filmed?
The shooting itself was filmed, yes.
Okay, go ahead.
So there's an author named Maury Terry who became interested in the case. And we've read his book, The Ultimate Evil.
By recommendation of Todd.
By Todd's recommendation.
right.
It's a fascinating book. It really is.
Yeah.
This book was published in 1987 and has since undergone several revisions over the years. Now, Terry has died not too long ago, so no more investigation there.
Yeah, now we don't have Breslin or Terry.
Right. But Terry presents some compelling evidence that Berkowitz was not the sole perpetrator, based on eyewitnesses' description of the shooter and the type and color of the vehicles involved, which we've alluded to or talked about.
Right. But I would say that I'd have to look at a picture of a Galaxy and a Beetle. They're both yellow.
Yeah.
So that could be a mistake people could make.
I don't think so.
No?
The Beetles are very distinctive.
It's nighttime.
They don't look anything like a Ford Galaxy.
Okay. I can't picture what a Ford Galaxy would have looked like, so I'll take your word for it.
Maybe the color, you can say, is similar, but there's no mistaking what a Volkswagen Beetle looks like versus other cars.
Yeah.
So in an interview with Terry, Berkowitz claimed responsibility for only two of the shootings, and that's the first one, Donna Loria, and the dual murder or shooting of a couple other people.
Valentina and Alexander.
Right.
Right.
So Berkowitz asserted he was a member of a satanic cult, and some of the shootings allegedly were to silence people who might have damaging information about the cult, while other shootings were ascribed to the goal of random killings by the cult.
Okay. So now, why would they want to do random killings? Just to terrorize people? Or?
Right.
I mean, what at the heart of a satanic cult, what is their goal? If you worship Satan, what do you want to do to the world? What is your, just to cause havoc?
You're trying to cause havoc.
Is there a specific purpose to what you're doing?
No, because these were other than what Berkowitz claimed were retaliatory killings.
Yeah, but there's no evidence that any of these kids knew anything about.
No, there's none.
Or knew any of those people, right?
No, there were none. So, largely impelled by these reports of accomplices and satanic cult activity, the Son of Sam case was reopened in 1996. However, no new charges were filed.
Right.
And the investigation was suspended due to the lack of findings. But it does remain unclosed.
So, open.
Right.
That's what unclosed means, right?
I know. So they reopened the case almost 20 years later, based on some of these assertions in Terry's book.
Well, because Terry did a lot of investigating. This wasn't just, he spent so much time in this. And Breslin spent a lot of time looking into things, and other people too that we haven't mentioned.
No, for
sure.
But
there was a lot of thought going into it. There were some really knowledgeable people who believed that there was more than one shooter. Maybe not the satanic cult, but definitely more than one person did the crimes, according to many people who were in the know.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And I'm of the opinion, based on the research that was presented in this book, that there probably were more than one shooter.
So you believe that?
I believe that. However, these Berkowitz claims are dismissed by many people. FBI profiler John Douglas, who's famous, is convinced Berkowitz acted alone.
Okay.
He feels that Berkowitz is an introverted loner, not capable of being involved in a group activity. And this guy, I have a book by him.
Really?
Douglas, yeah.
On what? On a different crime?
On profiling.
Oh, neat.
It's fascinating.
That does sound interesting. I'd like to read that.
Okay. It's right over there.
Yeah, I have like 98 other books I have to read first. I know.
And the New York Police Department psychologist Dr. Harvey Schlossberg and a forensic anthropologist Elliot Layton also firmly believe Berkowitz acted alone. So that's their opinion. My opinion is I think that there's enough people that are witnesses to these killings, and there's enough uncertainty about them. I'm believing that he didn't act alone.
But do you think it was a cult?
Well, that's the other difficulty.
I mean,
there's a lot of effort and time spent in the book discussing the satanic cult theory. And this whole part of the book was, I think, meticulously researched, but it stretches my credibility.
Well, you know, you also watched the interview, right?
Right.
With Terry and with Berkowitz.
Yeah.
And what did you think about that? I mean, I kind of feel like this Berkowitz just wants attention.
I do.
In many ways. And he is getting it, unfortunately.
But the interview, it's just, I did this one, someone else did that one.
Oh, okay.
I thought it was pretty good.
Okay. So what about these two cult members that he named that you touched upon? They were the sons of Sam, John and Michael Carr.
Right.
So these two men were Sam Carr's sons, who was a neighbor of Berkowitz. So strangely, both of them died. Now, John, he died of a shooting that was determined to be a suicide in North Dakota in 1978, and Michael died in a 1979 car accident. Now, Berkowitz had said that John Carr had done the DeMasi-Lamino shooting on November 27, 1976, and then he said that Michael Carr had shot at two other victims.
He said that.
Now, it's easy to say that when someone's dead, to say what they did, right?
Because he didn't name other people when he was disclaiming involvement in some of the shootings or being the active shooter. He didn't name names. The names he named were the people that are dead.
Right.
So there's no comeback to
that. That's a little suspicious.
Right.
Yeah. And did you talk about journalist John Hockenberry? Do you have any notes from him?
I don't.
Okay, because he wrote of some doubts that people had that Berkowitz had acted alone. And what was interesting about that is just that he said that D.A. John Santucci and investigator Mike Novotny, and I think they were both of the NYPD, both believed that Berkowitz had accomplices. So
yeah,
that's interesting.
Santucci for sure, because Terry refers to him frequently in the book. And he believed that Berkowitz had accomplices.
And then Hockenberry's report did get some media attention and was read on the local news, on the network news, and it was actually on Dateline in 2004. Now, we also discussed the work of Maury Terry, because Terry, like you said, he'd been investigating the Son of Sam shootings before Berkowitz was even arrested, and he was challenging the whole theory of a lone gunman.
Right. I mean, Terry looks like he made this his life's work.
Yeah, this is kind of an assembly of articles and things that he's worked on for years.
Almost like he was obsessed with the case.
Yeah, which you kind of, if you really want to learn about a topic like that, it really helps to have someone who's obsessed with it to look at.
Yeah.
Right? Because they will get you all the stuff.
He was like a dog with a bone. I mean, he just kept digging and digging and digging.
And I'd say he's mostly responsible for the Yonkers police reopening the case in 1996.
Oh, I think for sure.
Now, interestingly enough, though, Breslin was a skeptic.
Breslin's one of the skeptics. Breslin said there's no way he had accomplices. He did it all by himself.
Right.
And when you're talking about satanic cult, I mean, again, Terry spends an inordinate amount of time discussing this, and he purports to link Berkowitz's involvement with the cult with the Charlie Manson murders.
Yeah, now what year did those happen?
Those were in the 60s.
Okay.
And he also was linking the cult's involvement in the killing of a young wife of a Stanford University student. So that was
right at the beginning of the book, that killing.
That killing was. And I know that the research is there, but it seems like too many coincidences.
But, you know, what's interesting is the Stanford woman who was killed, she was from North Dakota, right?
Right, where there were a lot of cult members.
And the Carr brothers.
The Carr brothers were from there, Minot, North Dakota.
Yeah, so that's kind of interesting. That was something he touched upon. Now, Berkowitz, he describes himself now as a born-again Christian and says that an obsession with pornography led to his role in the Son of Sam murders. So he's had a lot of stories over the years, and aside from anything to find out for the victims' families, I think we should just ignore him. I think he's gotten way too much attention, and this is something that we've turned away from more recently, I think, is we try not to give criminals all this attention.
That's true.
Now, one major result from the Son of Sam murders that we did mention were these Son of Sam laws, and these laws came to be after speculation about publishers offering some big payouts to Berkowitz to tell his story. So the laws authorized the state to seize all money earned from the deals with criminals for 5 years and use it to compensate victims. But then in 1991, these laws were found to be unconstitutional, so they no longer exist.
Well, no, they've been rewritten.
Right, they're much...
to follow federal guidelines or whatever.
Right, so they're not as strict.
No.
Or ironclad.
But they're still somewhat in place.
Right, and not only in New York, but nationwide.
That's right.
Yeah, different states have different ones, I believe. It's a state-by-state basis.
It is.
Yeah. Okay, so good talk. Anything else you want to add?
No, I think it was a fascinating book, and I'm appreciative of Todd recommending it. It was just a very, very interesting read. And even though I don't agree with everything that's in the book, I love how well-researched it was. And I do think that he had an accomplice or accomplices.
So that's something that you got from it that you didn't think before reading it, I imagine.
That is.
Interesting. So it's pretty cool that he taught you something or opened your mind to the possibility of something.
I'll say that he opened my mind.
Yeah, because you're not strictly believing that. You're just open that it's possible.
I think so. I think it's more than possible.
Okay.
I mean, again, you look at descriptions of witnesses and in terms of people involved and cars involved, and there's enough ambiguity that I think there's more than one shooter.
Well, to me, I'm more just open-minded that it could be.
Okay.
Because I don't have that much faith in eyewitnesses.
No, I don't either. But they told similar stories.
They did. But to me, I don't know if I'd be able to tell a beetle from another car at night.
I think you would.
Okay. So I'm not sure about that.
At least the old beetles.
But it gives us something to think about for sure.
Absolutely.
And if anyone's more interested, that's a good book to read.
Absolutely fascinating.
Yeah.
Read it.
Okay. So before we move on to feedback, I just want to remind our listeners about Team Tie Grabber. Because for as little as $2 a month, you get a gift from us. And more importantly, you get access to our members-only podcasts. We have two in the feed now, but we'll be adding to it at least once a month. And you can join at tiegrabber.com. Also, please follow us on Instagram, on Twitter, at tiegrabberpods. Also on Facebook, facebook.com/tiegrabber. And we still love to get those 5-star reviews. We'll still be thanking people for those. Just because this was a commissioned podcast, we decided not to do that and just dedicate our thanks to Todd today.
Todd, this was a great suggestion. We really thoroughly enjoyed researching the case and reading your book.
Yep. Okay. So let's get on to feedback.
Okay.
All right. Goodbye to you, my trusted friend. We've known each other since we were 9 or 10. Together we've climbed hills and trees, learned of love and ABC, and skinned our hearts and skinned our knees. Goodbye, my friend, it's hard to die when all
Please pray for me. I was the black sheep of the family. You tried to teach me right from wrong. Too much wine and too much song. Wonder how I got along. Goodbye, Papa, it's hard to die.
Okay, welcome to Feedback.
Yeah, we got another beer for this, so it's time for Black Ops.
That's right. It's all poured and ready to go.
It is.
Yeah.
Looking delicious.
Yes, definitely. It is delicious. I've already tasted it, actually.
Oh, you snuck in there.
I did. That's right. You went on a bathroom break, and I took a couple sips, and you didn't even notice.
I didn't.
No. Okay, so the first one I have for Feedback, I have an email from Raphael in the Netherlands. So, in the episode on Reva Steenkamp, you touched upon the very lenient sentence. You also mentioned Joe O'Reilly, who could get an early parole even though he was sentenced to life. That's from A Husband's Rage, the murder of Rachel O'Reilly. Jill made a comment how the U.S. is somewhat tougher by comparison. I'm from the Netherlands and can confirm the truth of that observation. The cases outside the U.S. you can cover with more ease are for the obvious reason, in the English-speaking countries, the UK, Canada, Australia, South Africa, etc. Roughly the British Commonwealth. As the US was once part of the British Empire, these are countries who share many of the same foundations of the legal system with the US. The European mainland is where you find greater differences in the representative legal systems. In short, the sentences are a degree more lenient by comparison to the British Commonwealth, already forgiving compared to the U.S. The pros? We do have a small prison population, the system is wholly dedicated to rehabilitation, and by comparison we have a much, much smaller percentage of recidivism. Especially the latter is a strong validation that the system works. Lengthy sentences and harsh prison conditions don't improve the characters of inmates. It's basic logic. And if you're going to release them at one point, well, like many criminals themselves said, I received my education in prison, and they don't mean arts and crafts. So the biggest downside, however, the bereaved, next of kin, and the public in general often feel a complete lack of justice. Murderers who get 18 years, sentences automatically halved, and on top of that, they get early parole for good behavior. In practice, some are back on the streets after only a few years. I do feel we've got a better system when it comes to obviously mentally disturbed criminals. We've got what would roughly be translated as preventative detention. Sometimes it's a set number of years and sometimes it's indefinitely. It can be tagged on a prison sentence or it can stand alone. These are also the pedophiles, the rapists, the mentally challenged, low IQ, mental illnesses, the Munchausen by proxies, the psychotics, etc. Anyone with faulty wiring. It's a good solution for those in between cases, and when it's indefinite, they very well might be locked away for life, the psychopaths and the pedophiles. When it works, it's the best solution for this ongoing problem, what to do with people. Of course, no system is perfect, and even teams of psychiatrists and psychologists can be fooled or can make bad calls. Every now and again, one manages to get an out in some way and promptly commits another crime. The U.S. has the largest prison population per capita in the world. The majority serve time for victimless crimes. I feel it's all out of proportion and that we could talk for hours about the prison-for-profit system, the culprit in my opinion. On our side, we've gone completely overboard, though, in wanting to rehabilitate everyone and lost sight of the justice aspect. For me personally, murder is a crime where rehabilitation should take a second or third seat. These people need to be separated from the population, neutralized. Life should mean life. Perhaps parole them when they're 85. I wouldn't even be against capital punishment in some cases. Since that's politically impossible in Europe at this point in time, at least keep them away from society because unfortunately many aren't. If we were to take the best of all different systems around the globe, I think we could come up with a very improved situation for all. So I know that was a long letter, but I really liked it. I thought it was very informative and kind of echoed a lot of my opinions.
Well, I think so.
I mean, I really think we have too many people in prison in the United States.
We do. And I like his thoughts about kind of segregating the mentally ill people, the psychotics and so forth, from the others.
Yeah.
The trick is to determine what group you fit in.
Which is part of the problem, yeah, because right. It's hard to determine that.
It can be.
Yeah.
But I would think that there could be people able to be rehabilitated.
Well, I just think especially with drug-related crimes, we really need to look at drug users as having a disease and as not being criminal because they are addicted to drugs.
Absolutely.
And I know some of it leads to stealing and things, but I think that that really needs to be handled with treatment.
Yeah.
We don't have nearly enough treatment.
But on the other hand, if you're mentally ill, you're probably better off being treated or incarcerated.
Well, and that leads us to your next letter.
My next letter?
Mm-hmm.
This one.
Yeah, Stacey, who's that from?
Stacy from Canada, regarding Andrea Yates.
Which is a mental health case.
And I would only say that you wouldn't let me see these before we started, so I'm reading them extemporaneously.
Right.
So Stacy says, my feedback is regarding the Andrea Yates episode. Wow, that was a heavy one, so very heartbreaking. It sure is.
It definitely was a hard one to do.
I just wanted to say that I lost my mom to mental illness. She was only 62 and had suffered her whole life, but it wasn't something she talked about to anyone ever. She never married, and I was an only child, so to me, some of her odd behavior, I just chalked it up to, oh, well, that's just mom. When she is in her mid-50s, she did some really strange things, got fired from her job of over 20 years, and fell into a severe depression. I'm in Canada, and wow, let me affirm that our mental health care is very lacking. The hours I would spend at the ER with her waiting to see the psychiatrist on call, by the time she got to see one, she'd have all the right answers and be able to go back home. This went on for about 4 years. I would take her to doctor appointment after appointment, but she's only diagnosed with severe depression and extreme anxiety. She had never gone truly manic before this time, but when she did, well, that was not my mother. It was absolutely terrifying. The calls I would get in the middle of the night and at all hours during my workday, all while being a single mom to two very young boys. She would lie to hospital staff and the psychiatrist so they would never really know the full extent of her story. It finally came down to a point I had to trick her, using other people's help to just get her into the psychiatrist's office. He took one look at her, called the Royal Canadian Mounted Police, and she's put in lockdown in the psychiatric ward at the hospital. She was put on lithium, but I believe it was too late at that point for my mom. I could go on and on with the struggles I had to go through just to try and get her help, even calling adult protection services. I'd get her into programs, and she'd just leave without telling anyone she was going. She ended up starving herself down to about 75 pounds and then died by aspiration. It's a horrible thing to do.
Well, yeah, it's a very sad story.
She was kind of skeletal.
Absolutely.
I'll never, ever get over what I went through with her. I just wanted to say thank you for discussing mental health and the fact that in cases like this, a person is not themselves when they do the awful, unimaginable things they do that ultimately end up getting them the help they should have had once it's already too late. As for the guilty feelings, they are the worst, thinking what you could have done better, the what-ifs, etc. My heart goes out to everyone in both their families as well to anyone else dealing with mental illness in any shape or form. Until you've seen mental illness at its worst, it's really unexplainable. Thank you both so much for all you do. I look forward to each episode. But she's spot on with that.
Yeah.
I mean, the difficulty in getting help, and not just Canada. United States. You saw what Andrea Yates went through.
Well, yeah, I think that she made some really good points in relation to the Andrea Yates case because a lot of people are angry with Andrea Yates.
Yeah.
But I really feel like it was mental illness, and It's hard for me not to be angry with her husband and her mother-in-law and them, but, you know, we don't know what they were dealing with.
Right.
I'm sure it was awful.
And Stacy points that out.
And how can you predict that someone's going to do what she did? That was just such a...
No, you can't.
I mean, that just doesn't happen.
But imagine the guilt feelings involved.
I can't. Know? No, I can't.
No.
And that seems like a rough time for Stacy. Gee, to be a kid and going through all that.
And she was going through that, not just from childhood, but taking care of her adult mother.
That's right. And then losing her and feeling all those guilt feelings.
Her like that. Horrible.
Yeah. So she's been on the front lines, as you say, and she knows.
She certainly does.
So I think her story leads me to even feel more strongly about Andrea Yates being mentally ill and not being a murderer, you know, as you say. I mean, she did murder them, but not having any motivation to kill those children other than her extreme mental illness.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And I would only say otherwise to Stacy that, at least in the Andrea Yates case, our mental health care isn't any better than Canada's mental health care.
Well, I mean, we know that from children with mental illness, how they spend weeks in the ER waiting for placement. I mean, our mental health care is lacking in both countries.
Sure is.
Yeah. Okay, so I have one more that I'm going to read, and then you can read the last one. So this one is an email from Eva, and it's regarding Michael Peterson, who we talked about in the last two feedback sections.
We've been really involved with Michael Peterson.
Well, this might be the end of it, but I just thought she had written this to us, and I wanted to acknowledge it and let her know.
Okay.
So the message said, guys, don't exonerate Michael Peterson so quickly. Miss Radcliffe, who fell down the steps in Germany, had the same injuries to her scalp. Peterson was in close contact with her also. Kathleen found out that he was bi, and that frosted her kidneys, I'm sure. I really like that expression. I hadn't heard that before.
I haven't either.
It's cool. Listened to her sister's impact statement, and then she gave me a link to visit, which was ABC, a local ABC network, showing when he accepted the Alford plea. By the way, the tip of the blowpoke was broken, or so the sister claims. Please find the article and scroll down and listen to the sister. Maybe you'll change your mind. Peterson had a stone-cold look on his face, no remorse. So here's how people interpret things differently. I didn't see him as having a stone-cold look on his face.
I didn't either.
No, although I'm sympathetic to him because I have this owl theory in my mind. Now, I don't remember anything about the blowpoke being broken. It's been a while since we watched that documentary, but
it was
what do you think about that?
Covered with bugs and dirt and stuff.
Yeah, it looked like it hadn't been touched in.
And then there wasn't any mention of it, of a piece of it being broken off.
No,
nor
wasn't.
Was there a mention of the death in Germany having similar scalp injuries.
That I don't recall exactly. I know that it was a similar death, but I don't remember what her injuries were.
Right.
Do you remember what they specifically were?
Well, I remember that they weren't specifically mentioning scalp wounds that were later proven to be similar to what his wife suffered.
Yeah, and I haven't heard anything about him being prosecuted for that one either.
No.
Although they did dig her up. They did do another autopsy on that.
They did.
Okay. One thing I will say, I will give Eva, is that the sister... I think we were hard on the sister in our staircase series.
Well,
we thought she was kind of a bitch, and we did kind of say that. But then I look back, her sister was killed, and she thinks this guy did it.
Yeah.
And I will concede that he may have.
He could have.
He certainly could have.
We're just saying that the owl theory is a viable theory.
Right. But I think we were probably too hard on the sisters, is all I'm saying.
Yeah.
I think I would probably be the same way. She's standing up for her sister's memory. So that's the only way that I changed my mind on this.
Okay.
Okay.
We'll leave it at that.
But I appreciate the feedback. And then we just have one more short one, and this is a prolonged show.
One short one from Elizabeth regarding beer. I recently became a member of Tie Grabber, and I received my brand new snifter in the mail yesterday. I am so excited to put it to use. I was curious if you've given any thought to announcing which beer you'll be reviewing prior to the new episode. It would be a blast to sit down with a brew du jour while listening to Dick's review. Thanks for all your efforts and the lovely snifter. So, Elizabeth, yeah. I mean, we usually have been working on the murder for a while, so it wouldn't be any difficulty to publicize the beer that's going to be featured in the crime.
Okay, so, but this would be a chore allocated to you.
What?
Because I'm the one that has to put all the social media out and let people know, which is fine.
Okay, so my...
So you would have to have all this written out for me. You'd have to have a picture and everything ready.
My task will be to have not the review.
No, you don't have to have the review, but if you wanted to do like the next month of what the beers will be...
I can do
that. I don't think a week's long enough for people to access the beers necessarily.
All right.
So like if you want to, in sometime in the near future... Let everyone know what all the beers in May would be.
Okay.
And it can be on a trial basis. See how you feel about it.
Let me see what I can do.
Because we really have crimes out till July scheduled.
All right. So you want me to, I was thinking week by week, but you want it more than that.
I think probably it'd be easier to just have them listed out.
So let me see how this goes.
Because there's a lot to do week by week to get an episode ready.
So Elizabeth, I'm not going to do April.
No.
But I'll think about doing May crimes and having beers ready so we can get a list out and
yeah,
say...
Yeah, all we need is the name and a picture if possible.
Okay.
Okay. Peace so we'll give it a try. Let's try it for the month of May.
We'll start...
As a trial.
The later part of April, I'll try to get May's beers together with the dates so you can be ready.
Okay. Sounds good.
Okay.
All right. And then speaking of getting things in, if we could get our feedback in, the episodes come out Tuesday night. So if you want your feedback on the next episode of True Crime Brewery, we really need you to get it in by Saturday because we usually get our recording done by Monday.
Right.
Sometime over the weekend. And I like to read over the feedback and choose appropriate ones. So yeah, if you want to get your feedback on the show, please try and get it in by Friday. Otherwise, you might have to wait till the next week to hear it.
So get them in early.
That's right.
Okay.
Okay. And I think that's it. So I'd just like to wish everyone a great night, and we will see you at the quiet end of the bar.
You'll look for us down there. We'll be having fun.
All right. Bye-bye.
Goodbye.